Folks, so video number two. Hope you enjoyed the last one. It's literally just gone live now as I'm recording this one. We'll see how much interest it goes it gets as to how motivated I am to make this regular. Content will get done one way or another, but if it turns out popular or people are particularly interested, let me know in the comments and all that sort of usual YouTubey stuff, then that'll give me the personal motivation to do this more promptly for you guys. So where we left off last time then, we had our main, and we just had we looked into how the CMake build process works, and we looked at how we can compile a C++ file, even though the IDF is natively in C. Now the compiler it uses in the background, Stenza, is a well, it's built upon GCC, so it is more than happy with C++. And we proved that by doing a little hello world type thing. And as you can see, I fixed my VS Code integration. That, yeah, it was exactly what I suspected. It was because I copied and pasted various settings in this VS Code folder up here from another project, and it just balked itself. More than happy to do a video on that if people are interested or you come across a similar issue. But if you follow the extension install from scratch and don't try and do anything crazy in VS Code, having multiple windows open and stuff like that, you shouldn't really run into that issue. But let us know. So, what are we going to do today? Today, I promised we would do the good old Blinky. So, GPIO output is really what we're talking about here, and we're going to try and do it in a reasonably over-engineered C++ way. The interesting parts will be it'll be in a different folder, so we'll have to look at the build system. Should all just work. Our CMake lists is told to not that one. That one is told to look in application, set extra component dirs, not directories core. Oh yeah. Oops. Application. In my case, because that is this folder up here, obviously, if you prefer different names, then go for the one you like. But we'll stick with that. So now we can put stuff in here, and that's exactly what we're going to do. So let me just quickly pull up my notes, and we have ba-ba-ba-ba. Sorry, I thought I already had this open. Turns out I absolutely lied, and I do not. Application GPIO. Here we are. There we are. Oh, avert your eyes. There we go. So let's do this from a reasonably good coding practice point of view. Well, in my opinion, top down. Fantastic videos by Stanford University. Mehran Sal. Oh, I've forgotten his surname. Anyway, quite old videos. But it's on programming methodology. It's in Java. Now I've never written a line of Java in my life, but the videos are still absolutely valid. They're brilliant. Yeah, top. Programming methodology, the course is called. Highly recommend it. So we've made a GPIO folder within application. We're going to make a couple of files here, gpio.cpp and gpio.h. You could have that nested in an include folder as well for your 8 header files and whatever. Go with what you're comfortable with. GPIO not found in yet, go away. IntelliSense. So let's clear that down. And let's go to the header first of all. Usual include guard. I prefer the pragmas. Yes, the good old argument that define guards are better, and I think it is quite a valid argument actually. And yeah, but I'm sticking with what is my muscle memory really, until I get a problem with pragma once. Now we need to include a header from the IDF, so we're going to include driver / gpio.h, and we can see IntelliSense has already found it. Not IntelliSense, sorry, the autocomplete, which actually could be IntelliSense, I don't know. And we are going to do a namespace as well. Why not? Let's go the whole hog and over engineer the living daylights out of this thing. And we can probably get rid of our hello world that's flagging away down there. I like doing that at the end of a close brace, one that you know is going to span like a whole file, you know, multiple lines. Just remind yourself what the close brace is doing. VS Code, it's a bit easier because you can have the bracket pair colorizers and things like that. And the little bar that you get there, yeah, it's just good practice. You can never have too many comments. Well, you can, but yeah. And let's show off, since we're going massively over engineered, and let's create a base class. Something like that. In fact, I said we were going to do a proper programming methodology side of things, didn't I? So actually, let's do that. Let's ignore that GPIO base. So we want an output, first of all. GPIO output. Oh, I hate it when it does that. There we go. What does our output need to provide to us? Well, pretty much three functions. It's a digital output for what we're doing here. We won't worry ourselves too much about any analogy stuff at the moment. This is just a general purpose input output. So we're going to want a couple of functions. Makes sense to follow the IDF sort of methodology where most functions return the ESP error type. So we're going to want a set and then probably a state. We're probably going to want a toggle. Now, interestingly, because we are inheriting the error type, which it might inherit from gpio.h, but we should really... Oh, in fact, no, it is getting it from gpio.h. Right, never mind, ignore me. We probably want a toggle, so where we don't really care what state it's currently in, we just want it to change to the other one, in which case there's no input parameters. And then possibly a getter. I'm not a huge fan of setters and getters. But this, you know, this will evolve in a moment. In fact, yes, we will have a private member variable, which will be the state. And let's do it properly, really, shall we? And we can do in-class initialization as well. Which then means our getter is simple return state. And the reason we do it like that is because we could just make this public, but then anyone could change it to true or false, and it might not be what the state of the pin actually is. Whereas here, the only way you can get this variable is by calling this function, which returns it, but you've got no way of changing it. The only way you'll be able to change this variable is by calling the set method, which actually does the things. We could use the GPIO get function in here as well, provided by Espressif, but there's no need to be reading registers and so on and so forth, because we're going to set it up and we can just have that internal variable, and that is absolutely fine. This is an output. Okay. A couple of other bits and bobs we might want or need in this. Now, it's always good not to think too much about covering every single possible base. Just focus on what is going to be important to us. Now, I've got a little, the ESP that's doing the hello world, the ding, is currently sat there. It's a CTGO GP1 with a display. Obviously, that's not doing anything at the moment, because it's just doing a hello world. But we've got a little LED there. Now, the way I've set the LED up is it's actually pulled high, so it's switched on the low side. So that means that when our GPIO is high, the LED will be off. And when the GPIO goes low, it will be on. That means the logic is actually inverted. So this is a very typical way of doing things if you're working with N-channel MOSFETs or NPN transistors or whatever. Then actually setting a pin high, or to the VDD, VCC, whatever your rail is, actually turns it off. Now, we could remember that, and in our use case, just always remember that, oh no, it's inverted, so on and so forth. Or we could actually handle that in the code, which would actually... I've done both ways now, and I must say I do prefer if it's handled in the code, because chances are when you come back to this and your circuit's much more complex and you forget and so on and so forth, it's easy to mess that up and get your logic the wrong way round. So we're going to have another bool, which is going to be and this actually will be a const, because this isn't going to change. And we'll talk a little bit more about const and stuff later on when we get to it. Anything else we need? Probably not so much at the moment. We probably want some sort of initialization. So, good old init. And let's just stick void for the moment, and then let's come back to that, because it may not remain as a void. In fact, the most obvious thing at the moment is it's not going to remain a void, because we need to know what pin we're operating on. So actually, let's stick that in straight away. Now, within this header, and it's all on the ESP IDF API notes and everything, if you look at all that. I'm just doing getting all my info, excuse me, from that. So we're gonna pass it a GPIO num type, which is gonna be our pin number. And we're also gonna want to tell it whether or not that's wrong. So that's going to init the pin. Is this the best way of doing it? I would argue No, because we need to save this, right? Because we're going to need to know the PIN number later on in the setters and the togglers and things like that. So we need to remember the PIN we are using. And it's a const, so it's not going to change. Now, it makes not a lot of sense it being in the init. It makes more sense this being in the constructor, where we would have our constructor something like that, and then pin is gonna be pin like so. We're also going to want to tell it whether we're inverting the logic. Now, most of the time, you're not going to do that. So we can put a default argument in, perhaps. Now, notice the order we've got here. Pin actually comes after invert logic. So we need to make sure that is the case here. Like that. Now these two consts will get initialized and then they can't be changed. And that is good practice. It shouldn't ever change. It doesn't need to change. If we want to set up a new pin, then we will set up a new pin. And actually, at the moment, we can see nothing special is happening in this constructor. It's not doing anything funky, it's just setting some variables or some constants, as it were. So this whole thing can actually be a const expert like that, which means this will get all passed at compile time rather than at runtime. Although with optimizations turned on, it's probably going to do that anyway, but let's be, proper about this, I guess. So now all our init is going to do is call the initialization and the config stuff that we need for the IDF, but we'll get into that when we actually look at the implementation side of things. There's probably a few other bits and bobs that we might want. We might want pull-ups and pull-downs and things like that. But at the moment, let's just keep it a bit simple and assume that we're doing all of that in hardware. So we're not, we don't need to do too much on the configuration side of things. All right. Now it's probably useful to think a little bit about what else we might want, but let's not go into too much depth. So that's a GPIO output, but we're probably going to want at some point an input that might be on a button or something like that. So let's just have a little bit of blue sky thinking about what we're going to want on this. Well, we're not going to need a setter, because we're not going to be setting the pin, but we are going to want a getter to find what the current state of that pin is. So and that would return the state of the pin. Boyd, what's Boyd? That will return the state of the pin, whether it's been driven high or low by whatever the thing is, whether it's a button or what. So we're going to also probably need some sort of initialization function. We're going to need some sort of memory of the pin, what pin number we're actually talking about here. We might have some inverted logic again. This might be open collector, rather than open drain, for example, or something like that. So we might want the ability to invert the logic in software so we don't mess it up. But chances are this is most likely not going to be used, but let's put it in. Now, what can we see here? Let's have a look at the output. Things are starting to look quite similar, and we're going to have a lot of code repetition here. Code repetition is bad, very, very bad. And we want to avoid that where possible. We certainly don't want to be copying and pasting code and things like that, because the init function is most likely, or method should I say, is most likely to be very, very similar, particularly if we're calling the same IDFC functions and so on. So this is where I was jumping ahead of myself and started writing a base class where all the common functionality is going to live. And this is going to have to be an abstract base class, for the simple reason that different functions are going to have to do very different things in this output and the input. So for example, for an input, our setter is going to do nothing, probably throw an error, because we don't want to set a pin that we're trying to receive on. Doesn't make sense. That's the sort of the biggest case. But equally, if we, same with toggling, I guess, you don't want to toggle a pin that you're trying to read from. So that means that the base class is going to have to be abstract, because we can't define the set method here, because it's got to do two different things depending on the implementation. So let's sort of stick that in. But first of all, let's get our member variables in here. So what was similar between the two things? Well, we need to know what pin we're on. That's going to be the same. That is going to exist regardless of whether we're an input or an output. Inverted logic. Which we might or might not use. In this case, we will, just because of the way I know I've wired this up. We may also want to potentially save our configuration. Now, if you look at the IDF's guide and the way we configure it, there is actually a structure. That will house our configuration. Excuse me. We might also have a state, but we're not too sure just yet, because we might not save our state for the input, because we're probably going to have to read it each time. So we'll see about that one. But we are certainly going to want to know what that state is, and that's going to be different between the two classes. For an output, we can just return whatever we last set it to. For the input, we're going to have to read the pin and do something a little bit more involved. So this is going to have to be virtual. Well, it doesn't have to be virtual at all, but you could switch based upon the config and do a switch statement. But let's sort of, as I say, over-engineer the life out of this thing, just to give you a few more examples of what's going on. So that's not right, is it? State. And the sort of easy way of making this base class not, well, no, Let's see, how can I word this? This method we are going to need in all of the derived classes. So we can make this pure virtual, and that makes the whole class pure virtual as well. So that means that this method has to be defined in any base, in any derived class. Otherwise, the derived class won't compile. It doesn't make sense. So that will get our state. We may also have a setter. Like that. And we're going to make that pure virtual as well. We'll get on later as to why that's handy to do this. More for basically just to sort of skip ahead a little bit, it means that we can more easily pass around pointers, so the base class pointers and things like that. We'll go into it possibly in a later video anyway. I don't want to sort of try and paraphrase or put it the easy way and it get quoted as wrong too much. So that's effectively a getter and a setter. That's what's going on there. And we're probably going to want some sort of initialization. And this doesn't necessarily have to be public. Two sort of ways of doing this, really. Let's do it the way... How did I do it in my notes? Let's not do it that way then. Oops. We're going to have an init method, which if you look at the documentation for the GPIO driver, is going to be the same regardless of whether we're an input or an output. And that, I think, is about it. So, all that really remains is for the constructor. And this is going to need to know, at least, as a bare minimum, these consts, because it needs to initialize these constant members. So let's just stick those in. And it's going to need a config. Which I'm not going to make const. Or am I? Yes, I am going to pass it in as a const reference. We'll talk about that when we sort in a moment. Actually, we'll talk about that. And then we can have our defaulted invert logic as well. There we go. So this is getting a bit large, so actually let's do it like that, and let's put the zoom back to the way it was. Oh, there we are. So the constructor is taking in the pin, the config, and it might take in whether or not we want to invert the logic. That seems fairly reasonable. So we need to initialize these things. So pin is going to be pin. Usual C++ stuff. Config is going to be config. And let me just write this last one, and then I'll tell you about the reference. So passing this as a const reference, because it's const, we can't change it, and it's a const reference which will trigger this line here, because config is a struct, as we can see there, type def struct. It's going to trigger the copy constructor. If this wasn't const, it might, probably will, trigger the move constructor, because it can change this. So it can move it about in memory. That's not strictly how it does it, but this is a good way of ensuring that we get a copy. And that's what we want to do, because in whatever's calling this constructor, it might actually want to retain that information. There's arguments about both. We need to really know higher up what's going on as to whether or not we want to do a move or a copy here. And there are arguments to both, but it absolutely depends upon what the needs are and what's going on higher up as to whether or not we should be copying. Copying is typically bad. You should only do it if you have to, because it takes memory and time. In this case, it will be stack and time rather than heap, which isn't as bad, but it's still going to be bad. So how can we sort of make this a little bit better? Well, we can sort of be a bit cheeky. And make this a const expert, which will make all of this go away at compile time. Now, it does still have to do all the copying or moving or whatever, but it does it at compile time to figure out what's going on, which may be a little bit more acceptable than doing it at runtime. Realistically, for this size of class, you know, this happens in the absolute blink of an eye, so it's not going to make any difference whatsoever whether it was runtime or not. But you know, good if it can be const expert, typically make it const expert. Okie dokie. And that is probably our base class. Just twig there. That was red. Shouldn't have been red. There we go. And that looks pretty good. I'm just noting over at my notes here. Yes, that's fine. It's not actually exactly the same as my notes, because I'm actually slightly improving it. Now, in line with sort of good coding practices and so on and so forth, we can stick my absolutely least favorite C++ thing in there, because it just looks ugly and horrible, but a no discard. All this does is, if in your code you call this init method, and you're not doing anything with this return variable, this error type. You don't do anything with it, so you don't check it or you ignore it or whatever, you will get a compile time warning. That's all it'll do, just give you a compile time warning. And that makes sense in this case because we want to know whether or not the pin was initialized successfully before we start trying to use it, whether that is writing to it or reading from it. We need to handle that. Because if it wasn't initialized successfully, then, you know, we could just get at best bad information, or at worst it could cause, you know, serious problems. Say this was on a relay to a high power 2 kilowatt heater or something, and because the pin wasn't set up properly, it was just permanently on. You know, it could be a fire risk or whatever in that particular sort of crude example. All right. Now, that's virtual, so the definition isn't going to exist here. That one is also pure virtual. This one is not. So we can actually do this. And let me just pull up my notes. Yes, here we go. And let's do exactly that. So we're going to include the header. And we are going to do GPIO base init. And this was a no discard. I don't think you actually have to put that there, as far as I'm aware, in the implementation. But I like keeping things consistent. It certainly doesn't hurt. And it was a void and it's returning an error type. Okay, that's fine. Okie dokie. So we need to return something, so that's easy. Put that in, but we need to define what status actually is. And I'm going to use a method that a lot of people don't like here, but I must say I quite like it with the ESPIDF, but we'll see what reaction this gets. I'm not going to change, so I quite like it. Now, what we need to call is one of the API functions. The function is called GPIO config, and we need to pass it, as we can see here, a pointer to a GPIO config. Despite the fact that GPIO config itself is a struct, so it would be passed by pointer anyway, but yeah, whatever. So the easy way of doing this is we have our config already here, remember, but that's living there as a struct. So, but we need a pointer to it. Well, the easiest way of doing that is to put the address of config there. But we need to figure out whether or not this succeeded. So we could do that. And we could set status. Also, we could be well within our rights to do that, and then we wouldn't need this. So we initialize it there. If you don't like brace initialization, then we could do that. And in which case, we could make that actually a const. That would also be absolutely fine. But what I like doing with the IDF is this. And it looks weird, and I know a lot of people don't like this at all. If you don't like it, don't do it. That's fine. I'm not. This isn't a you should do it this way, but I'll tell you at least why I like doing it this way. ESPOK, as you can see there as I hover over it, is defined as zero. And if we actually F12 into this, we can see that there are lots of different types of error that it can throw. But all of them are a number. The only one that is ESPOK, and this goes through the whole of the IDF, so whether you're doing Bluetooth and Wi-Fi, and they've got their own defines for ESP Wi-Fi OK and GATS OK and so on and so forth, they're all zero. If it's not zero, it's an error. And you can do some quite interesting stuff actually here, because if you OR it, so this is OR equals, so that is effectively, well, it's exactly the same as saying that. It means if whatever this returns has any bit set at all, then it's going to set the same bit in status. But if this is zero and this is zero, well, the OR of zero and zero is still zero, so it will still return ESPOK, so it does all the things. This isn't a great example for it, because we only need to call this one function. But say we're doing something which we will be doing much later down the line where we're doing Wi-Fi, we might have to call lots of different functions. And we might not necessarily want to check for success after each one. We could do, but it depends on what we're doing. So we might just want to OR it together, and then we can just do a check for, oops, down here. And it is simple as that. So anyway, that's the way I like to do it. That's all it's doing. It's not doing anything funky. It's just a bitwise OR, which isn't a particularly expensive instruction, I don't think, as far as I'm aware. Let me know if I'm wrong on that, but I thought an OR was quite a cheap instruction. Anyway, the compiler might optimize this down actually anyway. And that's all we need to do with this. Now we've got a decision to make. This config here. Here. Now we're saying we're going to pass that in to the GPIO here, to our base class. And that probably is the way we want to do it. But we could, rather than passing this config in, we could generate the config ourselves in here. We're not going to do that this time, not in the base class at least, anyway. So let's look at our output. Input, we're not going to bother about this yet. We'll do that possibly in another video, because I haven't got a button set up anyway. So our GPIO output now can inherit GPIO base, and we can inherit all the public methods as public, that's fine. Ah, sip of water, lovely. Now then, slight problem here. These are private. There is an implicit private there at the start. That means our derived classes cannot access these. Can access these because they're all public, that's fine, but it can't access these. It's going to need to access these to be able to do the setters and the getters and so on and so forth. So two options really. We make these protected, in which case the derived class now can see it. Or we stick in some getters and set, sorry, some getters for these. So for example, Oops. Void, and then return 10, like that. This is horrific code bloat, in my opinion, and this could actually be a const function as well. It's just huge code bloat. I don't see any value in doing that for this particular example, particularly given that pin is already a const. So the derived classes can't change it anyway because it's const. So there's no point in this example of protecting it in this way. It doesn't add any value. So it's, in my opinion, for this example, much better to make these protected. And we could actually have a pin getter for as a public. So if we wanted to ask an instance of this class what pin it's on, for example, then that's probably something useful to do. But we'll do that as and when we come to it, really. Let's keep it reasonably simple. So we were looking at this config. Okay. So state, actually, let's go through this sequentially. State doesn't exist in the base class, so we're going to define that here, which will exist in the GBIO output. Inverted logic, we've already got that in the base class, and pin, we've already got that in the base class. So that goes. Now the constructor is still going to need it, but what it can do is it can just pass it straight down to the base class constructor. Oops. Like this. And what was the order? Pin config invert logic. So pin config invert, I just called it invert here. And that's the base class initialized, except it isn't. We've got a problem. We've got a problem here. We haven't generated this config, and I don't necessarily want the user, or the user doesn't necessarily need to generate the config structure. Let's just talk about that, because this is specific to this. This is the config structure. So there's a pin bit mask, right? Do I really want the user making a bit mask and doing all that sort of thing? Well, they don't need to, and they could mess it up. There's a mode, input or output. Well, in our case, we're an output, so we already know that. We know what the pin is, so we can generate the bit mask. Pull ups and pull downs. We might want those for an output, but we'll, for the moment, let's keep it simple, and we're going to just have a pull down. And interrupt. Well, it's an output, so we don't need an interrupt. So actually, all of this we already know at this point here. So we don't need to ask the user who's constructing this for that structure. We can generate it ourselves. And just to make this a little bit easier, let's go with that one. Let's just break this up, because this is going to get a little bit silly, to be perfectly honest, for this example. So we're going to generate a GPIO config type, and this is where haters really will start to hate. We're going to do some C style initialization here. So we have the pin bit mask. Right, there's method in this madness, so bear with me on this, for those of you who are big CPP nuts. Now, the pin bit mask is a uint64, and it's 1, left shifted by the pin number. All right, which some of you will chuckle on that, and there's a good reason why you would chuckle on that. But it's a UINT64. That's quite important because we're not on a 64-bit processor here. So we're going to actually have to do a static cast. To a UINT64. Oops. Of one. I think you can also do one ULL, and then you don't need the cast at all, unsigned long. I just despise long and int and things like that. As a bare metal guy, it's too many bugs come about from using those types. But feel free to do it yourselves. And then it's left shifted by pin. And we've got pin here, and that's the definition. That's in the IDF notes as well. The mode. Is this all going to fit on one line? Almost. Right. Mode is, well, we know that it's an output because we're in the output class definition, so it has to be, otherwise it makes no sense. The next one in the list is pull-up enable. Now, we said we're not going to have a pull-up. So pull-up disable there. The next one, unsurprisingly, is pull-down enable. Which I said we will have. That's just the way I want to do it for this. Realistically, it's a push-pull output, so it doesn't really matter. And then the last one is the interrupt type. And of course, it's an output, so it makes no sense to have this as a interrupt. So now we've generated this config and we've not needed to ask the user for it. All the user actually needs to give us is a pin number, and we generate this config and do all the good stuff. That's great. That is perfect for us, and we don't need to worry about anything in that case. Now, the init, we had this init function. We have already defined it here for the base class, so we don't necessarily need to have it here, but we might want it here. This is an output. It would be nice to initialize the GPIO in a known state. So what we're going to do is we're going to, again, use some of this horrible verbose nonsense, and let's make our init function for the GPIO output. And what I'm going to do is, let's just save a bit of typing. Now, we want to call the base classes in it, first of all. That's because that's doing all the stuff. What's the point in copying and pasting this? This is bad code, right? This copy and paste here is bad code. So what we can actually do is that, and we will call the base classes version of init, because they've got the same name here, don't forget, the output, so we need to tell it which one we actually want. And the reason I've done it like this is because for an output, it would be nice to initialize into a known state. So what we're going to do is we're going to call our set method. So set, and that would be logical. Set false to turn the input off. But what if our logic is inverted? We would want to send it high to turn the LED off. So what we want to do is false, but we only want to do that if our inverted logic is true, which I think had an underscore before it. So if we're inverting logic, we actually want to set it high. Yeah? Whereas if we're not operating on inverted logic, then false. This is a bit of a silly statement, though, because, if this, then true. If not this, then false. So that is identical to just doing that. Because inverted logic is a bool. So if we're inverting our logic, then we want to set the pin high. If we're not inverting our logic, then we want to set it false. So that's the easy way of doing it. And then we can return status just like that. Now then, it would make a bit more sense here to try not to set the pin if the initialization failed. So what we'll do is if ESP OK equals status, then we will do this. Oh, I hate it when it does that. And we'll do that. Always put your constant first, by the way. Not. Oh, very nice. Not that way round. Both mean exactly the same thing, but you've seen how bad I am at typing, and if you did that, that is a perfectly valid expression, but it won't do what you want it to do. That will set status to ESP OK, even if init failed. It's just going to overwrite it here. And then ESP OK is actually zero, so this evaluates to false, so it won't execute that. All things go wrong just because of one little typo there. So it makes more sense in my mind to do it that way round, because if you do that, this will not compile. Because this is a constant, and I cannot change a constant to whatever status happens to be. This is a compile time error. And trust me, the number of times people do that typo, me included, that just catches it. Much, much easier to deal with. Saves a bit more of a headache because it's very easy to miss a doubles equals there. Equally, you could have, bitwise operations and things like that. But whatever, in this case, that's fine. So that's going to initialize our pin, calling our base class initialization. Reason it's a base class is because it's common. So we've only had to write that once. And if it's an output, we're just going to do that initialization, and then we're going to set it to whatever off is, whether that is high or low, depending on the implementation. Simple as that. Now then, we're calling this set method, but we don't have a set at the moment. So let's just have a look at our thingy here, and let's just copy and paste that in. Ka-chink, ka-chink, and let's flesh this out a smidge. And this is nice and easy, actually. nice and easy to do, really. We're calling a method GPIO set level, sorry, a function GPIO set level, and we're calling pin, and we're going to call it with state. And that's all we need to do. But again, we need to account for our inverted logic here, which is where this gets a little bit more involved. So we have our state variable here. So let's have a look-see at this. If state and inverted logic, what do we want to do? So the user is saying, I want you to turn the thing on. Well, if we're trying to turn it on, but our logic is inverted, what we want here is false, yeah? This is sudo code here. Else if it's not inverted logic, so we can just collapse that down really, then it will be true. Oops. If the user wants to turn the thing off and we've got inverted logic, then we actually want to set the pin high. And if we haven't got inverted logic, we want to set it false. Already you can see this if else is huge. It's bonkers. Okay. I wouldn't want to do it this way, to be perfectly honest. And the way I would do it, or the way I have done it, should I say, is considerably more simple. We're going to have to use the this pointer. No, we're not going to need to use the list pointer. We're going to set state is equal to state. That means this variable here will map the user's wish. It's not necessarily what the pin is doing. All right, so we're just going to set it straight to that. And here, we need to work out whether we've got inverted logic. So if we've got inverted logic, and I'm going to use just an inline thingy-ma-bob here, ternary operator, that's the word I was going to look for, then we want to invert state. Otherwise, just pass state through. Okay, that's got a little bit long in the line, unfortunately. So let's do something like that. That's not right. There we go. So what are we doing here? So we're giving it the pin. We know what our pin is. It's a member variable, as you can see there, or member constant. If we have inverted logic, then we just want to invert whatever the state is the user wants. Otherwise, just do what the user wants. Simple as that. Nice and easy. Yeah, this is tabbed and everything and looks a bit messy because of my zoom level here. But is what it is, I suppose. We could do some logging in here as well. That might be quite nice to do. But we'll not extend this video too much. So now, pretty much, everything is in place. We've not done our toggle yet. but let's not worry about that. And we've not done input, but we won't be doing that on this video, so it's not too much of an issue. However, this definition is now wrong because the user is telling us what they want. Oh no, sorry, this definition is still correct. Yes, sorry, because it's mapping what the user wants. So we don't need to invert this or anything. Right, moment of truth. Let's hit build, see what happens. Oh, not a lot's going to happen. Because we haven't done what we need to do yet. So we need a CMake lists in here. So we're going to do a new file. And quite simply, we can more or less copy and paste this over here. Our source is not that, it's just gpio.cpp. Our includers is just dot, the one we're currently in. And the only thing we require is the driver component here. Don't need FreeRTOS, we don't need ESP common, we just need driver. Okay, and then it would be nice if we can actually do something with this and make an LED blink or something like that. So let's give it a go. So let's do an include of gpio.h. We're going to have, let's just do it as a public thingy in here at the moment. So, So we're in namespace GPIO. We want an output. And we'll just call it LED. And we're going to need to satisfy the constructor because we don't have a, or we shouldn't have a default constructor here. I should explicitly delete it, but I'm not going to. So we just need to give it a pin number. Now the pin number this is on is, if I can find it, with me troops, it is on pin 27. So you can F12 into this, so it's pin 27 there, which is just 27 anyway. So pin 27, and I told you it was inverted logic, so we'll stick a true in there. Oh, it's because CMake's not actually built it yet. And in setup, we actually want to do the init, so like that. And then we will do led.set true. False. Let's do it as a debug message. LED on, LED off. And then we're just going to loop around that. All right, moment of truth this time. Let's see what errors we get. If it all compiles first time, it means the compiler's not found the error yet. I'll be amazed. You always get a typo somewhere. Yep, there we go. Okie dokie, so let's have a look at this. I'm going to leave all this error stuff in and compile errors because I think it's probably useful to people. GPIO pin type does not name a type. Did you mean? Oh, I know what the error is here. I know what we've done wrong. So in our core CMake lists, we also need to include our GPIO component that we've just made. There we are. There's bound to be another error somewhere, but that certainly won't be helping. I don't know if that can span lines, actually. We'll find out. Yep, okay. So, here we go. Error, GPIO pin T does not name a type. Does it not? What have I done here? Oh, GPIO num T, not pin T. So let's just see if I've made that boo boo anywhere else. Oh no, it was just in the. Oh no, there we go. GPIO numt, numt. And actually, I'm just going to comment this out anyway because we're not using it. So save all, and in fact, clicking build automatically saves all anyway. Ah, and I didn't change the CPP file, did I? Oh no, we don't need to, it's fine. Chugga chugga chugga. Just gone over the hour 10 minute mark. I didn't want that. So error in constructor GPIO base. Error GPIO base. Config will be initialized after. Ah, okay, right. This is something I did mention earlier on. Yeah. Pin, inverted logic, config. Pin, config, inverted logic. We need to swap the order of these. That's in the wrong order. There we go. And while we're at it, we'll check this pin and then invert, that's fine. And states there as well. But yeah, that doesn't matter too much. Okay, cool. That will satisfy this. These squiggly lines will go. So I did think I'd check that. Dub, 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 dub. And if you get to the linker stage, that's normally good. And we get generated. So we've got a few warnings here. Worth checking these out. Ignoring return value of GPIO init. Right, yeah, here we go. Right, so this is the whole point. It's only a warning. Underlined in yellow there, and you can see it's still compiled fine. Why is it giving me a warning calling init? Well, if we look at our init method, it's declared no discard. What was the error? Ignoring return value. That's because why have I done it like that? Because if setup fails, if this init fails, then we should not progress down this way. Okay. So what we're going to is my little trick. Do a or to that. We are no longer ignoring it because we're doing this error check. So if LED init returns anything other than ESPOK, which is zero, then status will not return ESPOK. It will return whatever that error is, and this error check will fail, and it will cause the chip to abort, which is just a reset, effectively. So let's just compile that. So let's just check, change that to an info message anyway. Just want to show you or check whether the logic is the right way round. Because the way I've wired this up is it's inverted. Because the LED is on the high side rather than the low side. Just to prove the, gives the GPIO class a little bit more. Interesting stuff within it. There we go, connecting. I wish there was just an app flash button, app flash monitor. I'm sure you could probably set it up. LED on, LED off, LED on, LED off. There we go, so we got our logic the right way around, even though this is wired up inverted. But our class has taken control of that, and all we're saying here is I want the LED to come on. An LED comes on, then we delay, and the class itself, or the object, should I say, LED, knows that we've got inverted logic because we told it so here, and has handled the inversion for us. Simple as that. Hope you enjoyed. Next one, will be a bit of a surprise because I've not quite decided yet. See you then. Cheers.